So the sermon tonight is kind of kicking off a new series that we're starting. It's going to be covering a lot of end times events, prophecy events, and everyone should have a handout. We don't do this very often, but I think this is going to be useful. It's going to be something to bring home with you and to help study, especially as we get into this in the coming weeks. And I know we started off reading in the book of Daniel, but the topic for the sermon tonight is we're going to be doing an overview of the book of Revelation. Now, there's all kinds of different people have different beliefs on just regular doctrines from the Bible, but when it comes to end time stuff, this seems to be even a much wider array. A lot of people have different things, and it may seem puzzling. It may seem very difficult to understand these things. I mean, one, they haven't happened yet, right? So it gives you a little bit more room for understanding what is the Bible talking about. It's a lot easier when something's already happened to say, this is what the Bible's talking about because it's already happened. The prophecy's already been fulfilled. It's a little bit more difficult to understand completely the things that have not happened yet. And I'm not going to be one that claims to know every single thing and every single detail of what's going to happen in the future. However, we do have a book of the Bible that is called Revelation. And the beginning of that book in the first chapter, it's the revelation that's given unto John by Jesus Christ. Jesus appears unto the apostle John, and the word revelation, it means there's something being revealed. A lot of prophecy in the Old Testament especially is sealed up. And when you read the book of Daniel, you see at the last chapter, he's saying, seal up this prophecy for the time is not yet. But now we have, in the New Testament, light being shed on many of these Old Testament prophecies and new prophecies being given as well by Jesus Christ, by the Apostle Paul. We see in Matthew chapter 24, 1 Thessalonians, and in a few other places, we see these prophetic statements that we know are talking about end times events. God doesn't want us confused. Jesus doesn't want us confused about what's going to happen in the future. He wants us to know exactly, which is why he dedicated an entire chapter of the Bible. It's called Revelation, to reveal unto us this is what's going to happen. And throughout the Bible, you'll see, especially when it comes to hard times and tribulations and trials, you'll see that the warning is given to his people in advance so that way when those times come, when the hard times come, you're not going to fall. You're not going to be offended. You'll be ready for it because you've already been told in advance. When something just comes and blindsides you and you have no idea that is going to happen, it's going to impact you a lot more. It's going to knock you down. It's going to take you out maybe. But when you know something's coming, you could brace for it, you could be ready for it, you could prepare for it. And that is the whole point of giving us these prophecies and telling us what's going to happen in the future so that we can be ready for it. Now, we started off here in the book of Daniel, chapter number 9, because this handout that I gave you is actually, I didn't create this. But I verified every single note on here, and I'm in agreement with this chart. So this is a pretty nice graphic. I know the guy that put it together, and I was planning on doing this myself and just creating my own chart. But I figured why reinvent the wheel if I have something that I believe to be true already that exists? This is why I got this printout, and it looks pretty nice. It actually has a lot of detail to it, and definitely worth taking home and studying because it's got all of the references on here. It's numbered next to each thing, and down at the bottom it has the Bible reference of where you can go and find out why do you say this is the timeline of events. Now this is titled Daniel's 70th week. If you notice here at the end of the book of Daniel chapter 9, he talks about there's a week. And then there's 62 weeks, which adds up to 69 weeks. And then at the very end, in verse 26 there of Daniel chapter 9, it says, and after 62 weeks, at 62 weeks, shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. So this is that last week. He's going to confirm the covenant of many for 1 week, and in the midst of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease, and for the overspreading of abominations he shall make it desolate, even until the consummation, and that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. Now, all throughout the Bible, in modern Christianity, in the world today, when you go to a church, mostly what you're going to hear people refer to is the tribulation. And if you're asked someone about the tribulation, people say, oh yeah, the tribulation, it's a 7-year time frame near the end of the world, right? I mean, that's just basically. Now, you may hear a few different things from different people, but generally speaking, when people talk about the tribulation, they're talking about this 7-year period. But there is not one place in Scripture that's going to tell you that the tribulation lasts 7 years. Now, where we stand in this church, just full disclosure, if you're familiar with eschatology, which is just a study of end times events, if you're familiar with the different theories that are out there, we don't believe in a pre-tribulation rapture. We don't believe that God is, that Jesus Christ is going to come and take us away before any of this, any of the tribulation events begin to occur. Some people will call what we believe a mid-tribulation rapture, but I reject the nomenclature of that and some of the, you know, what's held as a mid-trib rapture has some varying views as well. We've got our own view. I call it a post-tribulation rapture, and the reason why I stress that is because inherently with the word tribulation is in the way that it's used in the Bible, it's very important when we're looking this up, we're gonna understand the end times, that we're not just misreferencing events. And this is called Daniel's 70th week as opposed to the tribulation chart, because where everybody comes up with their 7-year time, there is a 7-year time frame. But what is it called, right? And what we call it does matter because it gets people thinking in various directions, and we're trying to explain our position, people get confused about it. So Daniel's 70th week, the book of Daniel is really where you're getting nailed down this 7-year time frame. This is the 7-year time frame that we're referring to here. Some people call this the tribulation. We don't. The tribulation only lasts about 3.5 years, about half of that week. After that tribulation is when God is going to pour out his wrath upon the earth. And this, these are the Bible terms that are being used, which is why we use those terminologies. Matthew 24 talks about the return of Jesus Christ, and it says, after the tribulation of those days shall the sun and moon be darkened, and the moon shall not give its light. And that's also the same passage that talks about the great tribulation. Earlier in that passage, his disciples ask him, you know, what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And I mean, they're specifically asking about end times events. And he says, okay, this is what's going to happen. And he lays out, he says, there's going to be wars, rumors of wars. There's going to be, you know, false Christ coming. And he's saying, but don't worry, the end is not yet. All these things are going to happen. You know, things are going to be played out. But then he says, you know, he goes into more detail on what's going to happen. Then there's going to be tribulation like was not since the beginning of the world, nor ever shall be. And goes on about explaining that, about the tribulation, but still referring to the saints, referring to believers, warning them. And then it says, after the tribulation of those days, you know, there's these great signs in heaven, the sun and moon and darken, the stars fall from heaven, and then the Son of Man returns, and that's when the angels reap. They gather together the elect. And again, we're not going through the book of Matthew. I'm just kind of doing a brief overview of that also. Read that in your own time, Matthew 24. And then we see the rapture happen. Okay? And then God starts to pour out wrath, but that's not covered really in Matthew 24. I'm going to go over right with you right now what we see in Revelation, and to help you understand what Revelation is. So all of this is just really by way of introduction to let you know what I'm going to be teaching, the perspective we're coming from, that we believe that there is a 7-year time frame. The first approximately 3.5 years are referred to as the tribulation in the Bible. That is a time frame that believers in Jesus Christ will be experiencing. As every reference of the word tribulation, almost every single time, is referring to those who are believers. I mean, you look up that word tribulation, trouble, persecution in the Bible, it's almost exclusively talking about believers in Jesus Christ who are being persecuted, who are going through tribulations, who are going through trials. all throughout. So to think that at the end time it's going to be something different, well, unless I have a lot of evidence saying otherwise, there's no reason to think that we're going to be saved or spared from trials, from tribulations, from persecutions, because it's happened all throughout history. And Jesus is warning that at the end it's actually going to get really bad, because there's this great falling away. There's this great apostasy. The love of many is going to wax cold because sin is abounding, because the world is becoming a much more violent place, a much more wicked place, a much more sinful place. Well, it makes perfect sense that, of course, there's going to follow persecutions amongst those who believe. So we're gonna hit a lot of various topics in the coming Sunday nights. It'll be a Sunday night series. So if you're interested in this subject, keep coming back on Sunday night. I'm gonna go over various things a lot more in depth. But to help with the study, it's good to have a good overview, because Revelation, I mean, anyone will tell you this, Revelation has the most information when it comes to end times events. We've got a few other places. As I mentioned, Matthew 24. We look at the last few books, the last few chapters of Daniel. You know, there's a couple places in like Ezekiel or Isaiah. You know, there's a few places where there's referencing of future events. But the vast majority of our information is going to come from the book of Revelation. So a lot of confusion also comes from the book of Revelation. I'm going to start off saying that the book of Revelation, I believe, is given in chronological order. For the most part, there's one point, and we're going to get to that a little bit later, about chapter 12, where there's kind of a shift in the timeline, and it resets back and starts going through the events again. But we'll get to that. But it's key to understanding Revelation. Now, we're not going to be looking at a lot of scripture tonight. I have some more scripture kind of maybe near the end of the sermon. But if you want to take notes, it's a good time to take notes, because we're going to lay down the groundwork of what does each chapter cover without having to read through everything. So what I did, and this is a good study, you know, this is as a side note, it's a good way for you to study your Bible. Write this stuff down. Make summaries. Make a synopsis of what's going on, especially end time stuff. You want to figure out what's actually going to happen? Get the whole overview of it. Because what happens, I think some people feel like they get lost in the weeds when you're reading through all these chapters and you're reading through a lot of the specific details of the events happening and don't have that broader picture of the timeline of events that are going on. And there's a lot of confusion where things look very similar. You're reading about similar events and you're starting to think, maybe your whole idea of when these things are happening gets a little bit confusing. And we also see a lot of people that are always trying to relate every single current event to an end times prophecy. And that, I mean, that's always going to happen. And there's many areas where people are, you know, one good example is people talking about Gog and Magog. Well, this is Gog and this is Magog, like in our current area. Well, Gog and Magog, there's only reference two times in the Bible, in Revelation and Ezekiel. And you'll see when you study your Bible that that's talking about after the millennial reign of Christ. It's talking about Gog and Magog. That has nothing to do with our current, you know, era of what's going on right now. But again, that I'll probably cover that in a whole sermon by itself, because it's an interesting subject as well. Let's get started here. So Revelation chapter 1. And if you want, you could kind of skim through the chapters as we're going through them while I'm up here and giving an overview of them. But basically, Revelation chapter 1 starts off. You've got the Apostle John in the Isle of Patmos. And Jesus Christ appears to him, and he starts to receive this revelation from Jesus. He sees the candlesticks, and he sees this vision, and it's explained to him that the seven candlesticks are seven churches, and that he has a message unto the angels of the seven churches, the messengers of the seven churches. So in that's Revelation chapter 1 in a nutshell, right? I mean, you can read the whole thing, but basically John starts receiving revelation from Jesus Christ, and he says, here's what I want you to do. You need to give these messages to these churches. Now, chapters 2 and 3 are the messages that he is sending unto those churches. That's why chapter 2 starts off in verse number 1. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand. And he goes on, and he goes over the various problems that each church has, the good things, the bad things that are going on. These are real, actual churches that existed in John's day. That are being, letters are being written to them to help set them right and set them straight. And they're included in the scripture because these are things that every church can have problems with and struggle with. And they're here still for our learning, for our edification, and for our knowledge. But I do not believe or subscribe to the idea that these are talking about church ages. Some I've heard that notion before, but I don't think it stands up to the scrutiny, because you start looking at each individual church and say, well, when was this age? When was the the Smyrna age? When and you look at these various things and you can't really make it fit very well. Obviously, the Bible is very deep. There's extra meaning that can be applied in addition to what's on the surface. We got to be very careful in how we apply those things. You know, we always go to the Bible and always the service, whatever it's talking about is correct, it's accurate. We need to take that at face value for what it's actually saying. When you start going beyond that, you need to really be careful that you're applying it and that it's not contradicting any other very clear scripture. Not saying it doesn't happen. There's plenty of depth to God's word. But I don't believe that these are talking about church ages. I think this is still instruction. It's still useful for us today. But these are some events that were, or some churches that needed some instruction, need some help from John. So that's Revelation 1, 2, and 3. Revelation chapter 4 describes John going to heaven in his spirit. So he's in the spirit, and the doors of the windows of heaven's opened up. He's caught up into heaven, and he basically describes some of the things he sees there. Okay, he's by the throne of God, and he's describing what he's seeing in Revelation chapter 4. Revelation chapter 5, it describes this book that he sees that has seven seals on it. So what he probably saw in older times, we had if you wanted to protect a document, if you had a legal document or something, and you didn't want it tampered with, and it was private matter, You roll up your scroll, or you have your thing, or even a book, you can do it, and you put like a wax seal on it, right? So that way it's obvious if someone tampered with it, if it's broken, then it's been opened up. And so there's this book, John sees it, there's seven seals in this book, and people are kind of mourning because they're saying, well, who's gonna open this book? We wanna know what's inside of this book. And then it's given to the Lamb, of course, of Jesus Christ. He's worthy. He's able to open up this book. And that's what Revelation chapter 5 is about. And this is all still just leading up to receiving this revelation of the prophecy of end times events. The book contains the prophecies of the end times events. So Revelation chapter 6, we see the first six seals being opened and what they are. So seal 1 is the white horse. And he that sat on there is coming in to conquering and to conquer. So the very first seal that's opened. And you can see this starts off, essentially this is starting off right at the beginning of our chart. This is right at the beginning of entering into this seven-year period. Okay? Is when the first seal is opened. And this is, it's basically, it's not delineated here. But I believe it's the Antichrist that's on that white horse. And he goes forth conquering to conquer. And basically he's setting up the one world government. Seal 2 is opened. That's the red horse. And peace is taken away from people. And people are killing each other. So there's a lot of chaos. There's a lot of wars going on. Seal 3 is the black horse. And the black horse brings the famine. And where the food prices skyrocket. It talks about wheat and barley being like a day's wages or more for just a small measure, just a little bit. It's because it talks about a penny. And a penny in the Bible days is about a day's labor. And again, I can't take all the time to prove all these assertions I'm making tonight, but as far as the penny being a day labor and stuff. But look into it. It's definitely talking about a famine. It's talking about the prices going up. Seal number 4 is the pale horse. And it says death and hell followed with him. And the fourth part of the earth is being killed with sword, with hunger, with death and beasts is what the Bible outlines here in Revelation chapter 6. Now, so far, so far up to this point, Everything that we're seeing are things that can normally happen in the world at any given time. Someone conquering and making war. Yeah, that's happened all throughout history. You know, peace being taken away and a lot of warfare. Famines where food becomes extremely expensive. This has happened again. It's happened throughout history. Now, maybe a greater scale during this time, but it's still not something completely unnatural or supernatural, if you will. And then a whole bunch of people to the fourth part of the earth. That's a huge number. It's a lot of people, a lot of devastation from all of these events being killed. It says, you know, some with the sword. So in battle, you've got people just dying of hunger. You've got people dying for other reasons. It says just death and beasts, the animals coming in and destroying and eating people and destroying them. These are all going to happen at the fourth seal. Seal number five talks about the saints being martyred. So again, seal five is talking about believers in Jesus Christ, those who the saints are. A saint is not, the Catholic Church has a different definition of a saint than we do, and then the Bible does. They have people who achieve a status of like holiness, if you will, to where they achieve sainthood. But the word saint is rooted in the word sanctify. It's the same root. We are saints. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you are sanctified through the blood of Jesus Christ. You're completely separated. You're washed of your sins, and that makes you a saint in Jesus Christ. So you got to remember that when you're reading. Again, don't get screwed up on some of these other concepts that are thrown out there by other churches or other beliefs. A saint is very simple. A saint, it's literally talking about a believer. Saints being martyred when seal five is open. And they go to God and they're asking him, God, we've just been killed for you and for believing on you. When are you going to take vengeance on these people? When are you going to right the wrong? Because God is the judge. And you read through the book of Psalms and David's always going to God, and God's the revenger. God's our defender. God's the one that we go to, right? We don't take matters in our own hands. But when people are getting martyred, now people are in heaven. The saints are in heaven. And they're confronting God, just saying, God, how long are you going to let this go on? I mean, our people are being slaughtered down there. And at seal five, he explains that they need to wait a little bit longer until their brethren are killed just like they are. It's still not according to God's time yet. But the reason I'm bringing this up and making a point out of it is that this is still talking about believers, even all the way up to this point when seal five is opened. Seal six, the sixth seal now, and this is in Revelation. This is all these seals are described in Revelation chapter six. So we're six chapters into the book, and it's describing these seals. And you see an event that takes place in Revelation, in seal six, in Revelation chapter six. The earth, there's an earthquake, the sun is blackened, the moon becomes as blood, stars fall, the heaven departs as a scroll, and the rich and the mighty men and the rulers get scared and they try to hide from the face of God in the dens and in the rocks and in the caves. They're trying to hide away from the face of God because they know God's coming and they're scared. That is the sixth seal. And remember, there's seven seals in this book, and that is what ends Revelation chapter six. Now, this one event, in order to understand end times prophecy, you want to get this event down in your mind and use this event. This is a very good place to kind of use as a marker. Let's say you don't agree with this chart or whatever. Make your own chart and use certain events that are talked about in multiple places throughout Scripture as your point of reference. This is dramatic. I mean, an earthquake, the sun going black and the moon turning into blood and stars falling from heaven, how many times do you think this event is really going to take place in the future?
Once.
I mean, it is so dramatic. It is so devastating. I mean, it's like, this is not the type of event that's going to be like, oh yeah, it happened once, and then it's going to happen again, and then it's going to happen again. It's very unique. So this is one of those things that use that as a frame, as a time point. When you look at Matthew 24, when you look in Daniel, when you look in Isaiah, when you look in these other places, and it's referring to these events, that this is a very big thing. It's going to be key to helping you understand when things are going to take place and what's going to happen in between her. So that's Revelation chapter 6. It goes through all the six seals. And I believe all of these events happen while believers are still on this earth. And those events that are recorded in Revelation or in seal 6, the month, you know, the sun being dark and the moon turning to blood, are also what happens when Jesus Christ returns and the saints are raptured up. And you'll find that in Matthew 24. It's the exact same description being given to us there. Revelation chapter 7. So we're continuing through the Revelation. Chapter 7, God stops the angels from pouring out his wrath. His angels are ready now to pour out God's wrath on the earth. And he holds them off for a minute and he says, wait, we need to seal the 144,000. So maybe you've heard of the 144,000. This is something that the Jehovah's Witnesses think that there's only 144,000 people going to heaven at all, because they completely misinterpret what the Bible's saying here. But if you look at it, the 144,000, there's 12,000 out of every tribe of Israel. So it's talking about Jews. And not only is it talking about Jews, it's talking about male Jews. And it's not talking about just male Jews, it's talking about male virgin Jews. Read it in the scripture. It's when it describes the 144,000, it's a very specific, unique group of people. But what's interesting about this is that these people are already in heaven. They're being sealed with a seal from God. And they're being sent to preach in the world, and they're going to be a witness in the world during this time of tribulation or of wrath. Really, it's not tribulation, it's time of wrath that's coming. The tribulation has already been taking place up to this point. They're being sent down now, 144,000 Israelites being sealed. And they are sealed so that they are not impacted by the plagues that are to come. So everything, all the wrath that God's going to be pouring out, they're going to be just fine. They're going to make it through these things just fine because they're sealed by God. And then in Revelation chapter 7 as well, besides the 144,000 being sealed, there's this great multitude of people that appears in heaven. And it's an event. John's just like, well, who are all these people? That all of a sudden, you know, he's in heaven. Because remind you, at the beginning, John is in heaven. He's witnessing things to come. Jesus Christ is explaining to him, here's what's going to happen. He's seeing visions of things that are going to happen. He sees the book. He sees the seal. He's recording and writing down for us what he's seeing. He's still in heaven. All of a sudden, boom, there's all of these people, a huge multitude of people just show up, just appear. They weren't there. Now they're there. And it says in the Bible, in Revelation chapter 7, that they came out of great tribulation, and God wipes away the tears from their eyes. This is the event of the rapture happening in the book of Revelation. It only makes sense. I mean, at the rapture, when Jesus Christ comes back for his people, there is going to be a huge multitude of people that are going to be raptured up, that are going to be taken, that are going to appear in heaven, and they're all going to come about the same time. I mean, literally at the same time, because it's right when Jesus comes back to get them. So we're matching up pretty good, and I think this is a good understanding. Let's keep going through this. That's Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 8 is when the seventh seal is opened. So that book had seven seals. Revelation chapter 6, we saw the first six seals. Revelation 7 is kind of in between there, and he's preparing for that seventh seal to be open. And it says when the seventh seal is open, there's silence in heaven for 30 minutes. So we've got nothing going on. And then the seven trumpets are handed out to seven angels. And now is when God is going to avenge the saints as their prayers are brought up in a censer before God. The prayers of the saints are brought before God, and then they're cast down as a fireball to the earth. And really, that seventh seal, there's nothing else to the seal other than the beginning now of the trumpets. The seven trumpets. That's what starts the seven trumpets being handed out to the angels. So if you'll notice on our chart, in sequential order, we went through the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth seal. The sixth seal, you've got the sun and moon being darkened, the stars fall from heaven, and heaven departs as a scroll. this is the time, this is the midpoint, essentially, of that pretty close to the mid, just after the midpoint of that 7-year period, the rapture, and then the seventh seal being opened, and now you start your wrath. And you've got the seven trumpets that are going to sound sequentially in order. So what we have in Revelation 8, trumpet 1, is hail and fire mingled with blood, where 1/3 of the trees and all the green grass is burnt up. Now we're getting into the supernatural stuff. Now we're getting into these events that when people talk about the plagues and like the scary stuff of Revelation, this is the real, you know, this is the stuff that there's no doubt God is doing this. This has not happened normally. The wars, the persecutions, the tribulations, the famines, these things have happened, and it's been pretty normal. It's not supernatural. God may have had his hand in those things, but it's not just some completely supernatural event. Hail and fire mingled with blood being cast down to the earth, with 1/3 of all trees and all the green grass being burnt up. That is a huge phenomenon. That is a supernatural occurrence. That's trumpet one. Trumpet two, it describes something like a mountain on fire. So maybe a volcano, I don't know, right? But that the description it gives, like this mountain, as it were on fire, cast into the sea. And it says 1/3 part of the sea becomes blood, 1/3 of creatures die, and 1/3 of ships are destroyed. Trumpet three, there's a flaming star from heaven that falls into 1/3 part of the rivers and fountains of water, and it poisons those water, and that's referred to as wormwood, and people die from drinking the water. I believe that sounds like a comet to me. I mean, a meteor, something coming that's radioactive probably because it's poisoning the water. They call it wormwood, and it comes down and it hits the earth, and 1/3 part of the rivers and the waters are all poisoned, and people are dying as a result of that and from drinking the water. That's trumpet number three. Trumpet number four, 1/3 part of the sun, moon, and stars go out. The Bible says that the sun is smitten. So probably another cosmic event happening, you know, something ramming into the sun, causing it to lose its, you know, 1/3 part of its brightness, of its shining, and which also affects then the moon and the stars as well. And that's trumpet number four. And that's Revelation chapter 8. Revelation chapter 8 goes through trumpets 1 through 4. Revelation chapter 9, you've got the fifth and the sixth trumpet. The fifth trumpet is the locusts from hell. Like literally hell has opened up, and there's these locusts that come up out of hell. And they've got, it talks about, I think it's their tails are like snakes, and they sting like scorpions, and they're these horrible looking things. They've got a breastplate and hair and a crown, and you know, you read the chapter and it's something else. It's not like anything on earth. But these are the locusts from hell that come up and start tormenting men for 5 months. And then trumpet six sounds, and that's when the four angels are loosed from Euphrates to kill 1/3 of men. And they lead 200 million horsemen. And the fire, smoke, and brimstone that comes out of the horses' mouths are what's used to kill people on the earth. Very serious. You know, trumpets 1 through 6 there in Revelation chapter 8 and 9. All things that are no doubt coming from God, and all things that have huge devastation on the earth. This is God's wrath being poured out on the earth. This is what we're seeing. And this is why when the Bible says that, you know, God has not appointed us to wrath, that's absolutely true. His people, his saints, are going to be raptured. We're going to be taken out of this world, because we're not appointed to this wrath. And that's why the 144,000 that he was sending down there got sealed in their foreheads, because they're not appointed to that wrath either. Right. God's people are not appointed to this wrath. Right. And that's why it's very important when we talk about what we believe in a post-tribulation, because, you know, hey, tribulation's going to come. We're warned all throughout the Bible, all throughout the New Testament, that there are tribulations, there are persecutions. He says, but be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. So Jesus said to us, you know, we could still be comforted. We will go through tribulations, but at the end, after the tribulation, before God pours out his wrath, he's going to rapture us out and then pour out his wrath on the rest of the unbelieving world. So after all of these events that the Bible describes in Revelation chapter 9, even after the locusts from hell and the angels being loosed and people being killed by these horse out of from the horse's mouths, the fire and everything else going on, people still do not repent of their wickedness. It's like people are still living wickedly. After all this stuff is happening, it's just not getting through to them. And then in Revelation chapter 10, the Bible describes a mighty angel clothed with a cloud, a rainbow on his head, face as it were the sun, feet as pillars of fire. One foot was on the earth and the other on the sea. And it's told that the sounding of the seventh trumpet brings the end of time and the end of the mystery of God. That's what is outlined in Revelation chapter 10 about that seventh trumpet. And then John takes the little book and he eats it and he's told that he needs to prophesy. That's Revelation chapter number 10. Revelation 11 is the two witnesses that the Bible is very specific about, that the two witnesses prophesy for 1,260 days, which equals exactly 3.5 years if you're doing your years based on 360 days, 30 days in a month. Okay, that's 3.5 years exactly. And the Gentiles tread the holy city 42 months. Again, 42 months is 3.5 years exactly. Verses 1 through 13 of Revelation 11 provide a summary of the two witnesses ending just before the seventh trumpet sounds to try to figure out where those two witnesses play into end times event. That's why I'm bringing this up. It's that they're in that latter part of that 7-year period because they're there all the way up until that seventh trumpet. And the seventh trumpet is basically like kind of the end of the 7 years. And then verse 14 of that chapter, because verses 1 through 13 talk about those two witnesses, and then verse 14 brings us back to the timeline of events in the seventh trumpet. Jesus sets up his earthly kingdom. There are lightnings and voices and thunderings and an earthquake and great hail is what's being described. And that's Jesus setting up his millennial kingdom, which happens after the whole 7-year period. That's the millennial kingdom of Jesus Christ. Revelation chapter 12 now. See, that's Revelation 1 through 11. Revelation 12, when you start reading in Revelation chapter 12, I'm going to turn there real quick. Turn if you would. We basically get a little bit of a time warp back to the birth of Christ. Now, obviously it jumps through the time real quickly, but it's giving us now... It's a very solid indication that there's a change coming because, there's more that needs to be described. There's more vision that's being given. There's more that's being revealed. But the way that it was revealed in the first 11 chapters makes sense because it was chronologically going through. You've got the first 7 seals. You've got the 7 trumpets. And it ends with Jesus Christ setting up his millennial reign. That's where that whole series ends. Now, God's not done giving us information about that time frame, but then at the end of Revelation, it goes into the millennial reign and after the millennial reign, and things are going to happen after that. So there's a little bit of an overlap now in the middle of Revelation, but it's very clear. Revelation chapter 12, verse 1, the Bible says, "And there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she, being with child, cried, travailing in birth and pain to be delivered. And there appeared another wonder in heaven. And behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. And she brought forth a man-child, who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up unto God and to his throne." There's not a lot of argument or disagreement about that this passage is talking about Jesus Christ. I think it's pretty obvious. We know from Scripture that the life of Jesus Christ was sought, right? That's why they fled into Egypt. That's when there was every child, every male child from 2 years old and under was killed in the land because they were trying to kill Jesus Christ. I believe that was of the devil. That was of Satan trying to devour the child, trying to kill him before he could ever grow up and become the Savior. Being thwarted. And then, the woman says being fled into the wilderness. And then, that's later. That's in verse number 6. But in verse number 5, he's the one that's going to rule with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up unto God and to his throne. Jesus Christ is sitting at the right hand of God the Father, right next to his throne. So this is a very different picture of what's going on. And it's done to help to really just kind of say, hey, look, this is changing. You know, this is where we're at right now. And then the chapter continues. It talks about Satan trying to kill him. He controls a third of the angels. There's a war in heaven. Satan is cast out. And it says the woman is kept from the dragon for 3.5 years. And what you'll notice throughout the book of Revelation is the 3.5 year time period coming up repeatedly. And there's different events being referred to, but the fact that it's 3.5 years every time should stand out to you and try to figure out what is that talking about. And I believe the 3.5 years is the delineation essentially between the tribulation and God's wrath being poured out, and that is the timeline of when the rapture occurs too. And you can see all of these various time underneath the timeline. You've got the 1,335 days talked about here in Daniel chapter 12, where it says, blessed is he that waiteth and cometh to the 1,335th day. We've got the 42 months of the Antichrist in power, 1,260 days of the two witnesses, and the 1,290 days from the abomination of desolation being set up. All of these are very close, roughly 3.5 years, or if not exactly. Just want to point that out real quick. Oh, there's my JFW's stuff from Soulwinning today. All right, let's continue on here. Revelation chapter 12. So we got that time warp. And then in verse 10 in Revelation chapter 12, it says, and I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil has come down unto you having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. And I want to point this out, that I believe this is what kicks off the tribulation, this event. Many people think that this happened a long time ago, that where Satan is kicked out of heaven, but I don't believe that to be true. Because you have to figure out when did the devil get kicked out of heaven? It had to happen at some point, or it hasn't happened yet. A lot of people think it happened way back when sin was found in him, you know, going back to the Garden of Eden when he was kicked out of heaven. But that doesn't make sense, because in the book of Job, it's very clearly recorded that Satan is in heaven. And he's talking to God. He said, well, whence comest thou, Satan? He's like, from going up and down the world and, you know, going about in it. And, you know, he's going back and forth. He's walking around through the earth and he's in heaven. He's not been cast out yet. We know that Satan, as a roaring lion, you know, is seeking whom he may devour on this earth. You know, Satan is the adversary, he's the enemy. But he has not been cast out of heaven yet. And this is what begins this great, you know, because he has great wrath. When he's finally kicked out of heaven, now he's really angry. And who is he angry with? He's angry with the saints. He's angry with the believers in God. He's angry with God, and he's angry with anything to do with God and anyone that believes in God. So his wrath is what starts the great tribulation against the believers. The persecution starts and brings all the bad times against people. And that's what we're seeing getting kicked off here in Revelation chapter 12. And that's why it says, woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil has come down unto you having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. He doesn't have much time. From the time he gets kicked out of heaven, he's got about 7 years before he's thrown into the lake of fire. That starts the tribulation. Then in verse 17 of Revelation 12, it says, and the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Believers in Jesus Christ are being persecuted. And that's who the dragon is angry with or wroth with, is has this great wrath against. That's in verse 17. That's Revelation chapter 12. So that's kind of starting us back over. And now we're picking up the timeline again, saying, okay, the devil's kicked out of heaven. Revelation chapter 13 now describes this beast. And it's a beast that has 7 heads, 10 horns, and 10 crowns. One head is wounded to death and then is recovered. The dragon gives the beast the power that it has. The beast is a superpower in the world. The beast was given power, it says in Revelation 13, to continue 42 months, again, 3.5 years. The beast, it tells us in Revelation 13, makes war with the saints and overcomes them and blasphemes God and receives worship. So we have essentially being wrapped up here in Revelation 13, you're going to have the one world government being set up, the Antichrist coming into power, making war with the saints, bringing great tribulation against them. He sets up his own, you know, he's the one who stands in the temple of God proclaiming that he is God, right? The great blasphemy. And then it says another beast arises in Revelation 13, 2 horns. He speaks like a dragon. He uses miracles and signs and gets people to worship the first beast and makes an image to the first beast. And he brings the image to life and causes everyone to get the mark of the beast, which Revelation 13 explains is 666. That's where the infamous mark of the beast comes from. And it goes into this detail. And these are events that, and the reason why I believe that the book of Revelation is kind of split up the way it does is because all the seals were being given in order. And there wasn't, you know, instead of kind of breaking everything apart and kind of going on these different rabbit trails, we see a very good chronology being given in those first 12 chapters, the first 11 chapters, and then in chapter 12, now giving more detail of, okay, during this tribulation time, here's some more information. You're going to have the Antichrist. He's going to have this wounded head that's like mortally wounded and then comes back to life. There's going to be this mark of the beast. No one's going to be able to buy or sell unless they have the mark. And all these things are going to happen. And this is when the abomination of desolation also is going to take place, is during this timeline, which is, again, a whole other subject. I'm going to have an entire sermon dedicated to that. Revelation 14, we see the 144,000 getting sealed. So now we got some overlap. We already saw the 144,000 being sealed in Revelation chapter 7. Now in Revelation 14, we're seeing the same event take place. It's not a different event. It's not a whole new 144,000. It's the same people being sealed. So we've gone back in that time, and now we're at the chronology that we were at in Revelation chapter 7. 144,000 are sealed. It says the hour of God's judgment is come, which means God has not yet started to pour out his wrath, very consistent with Revelation chapter 7. The earth is reaped in Revelation 14. Again, that lines up exactly with what I was saying about the rapture taking place in Revelation chapter 7. Well, when the earth is reaped, God reaps the believers. That is also the rapture happening in Revelation 14. Revelation 15, you have the 7 angels prepared with the 7 plagues of the vials. Now, I don't believe that the vials and the trumpets are the same thing. But when you read them, there's a lot of similarities between the vials and the trumpets. I think they happen concurrently because of all of the similarities that are going on between them. I believe that there's going to be an angel sounding with a trumpet the way that it was explained in Revelation 8. And I also believe that there's going to be angels with vials that are going to be pouring things out on the earth the way that John saw them. And they're unique, but they're consistent with each other, and it's very consistent to be happening at the same time, which again is the way that this chart has it given here. And it even has in red the similarities here of what's being affected. So when you see the first trumpet and the first vial being poured out, the similarity there is the earth, then the sea, then the rivers, then the sun, darkness, Euphrates, inhale. These are the similarities between the two events that are happening, showing, you know, the correlation there, the connection. So in Revelation 15, it's just the seven angels are prepared with the seven plagues of the vials. Then in Revelation 16, the vials start to be poured out. And these are the vials of God's wrath. Vial 1 is a grievous sore. Vial 2, the sea becomes blood and every living soul in the sea died. And these, you know, you remember, we were just going over these with the trumpets. Vial 3, rivers and fountains of water become blood. Vial 4 is poured upon the sun and it scorched men with great heat. Vial 5, poured upon the seed of the beast. His kingdom was in darkness then. And then in vial 6 is poured upon Euphrates and the water was dried up. And also in Revelation 16, it says there was lying wonders by the beast and the false prophet and the dragon. And then Armageddon happens in Revelation 16. And then is when you finally come to vial 7. Vial 7 is poured into the air and the statement, it is done from heaven. It's done. Thunder, lightning, great earthquake. That's how Revelation 11 ended. Remember, Revelation 12 was a time war back. Revelation ends with the thunder, the lightning, the great earthquake. So now we've ended that same time frame that Revelation 11 ends with. That says, there fell upon men a great hail out of heaven, every stone about the weight of a talent, and men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, for the plague thereof was exceeding great. Revelation chapter 17 talks about the judgment of the great whore Babylon, drunken with the blood of the saints. It says, the woman which thou sawest is that great city which reigneth over the kings of the earth. The 10 kings will hate the whore and destroy her and give their power to the beast. Revelation 18, again referring to Babylon, talking about Babylon has fallen, and the entire chapter describes this Babylon. Revelation 19, rejoicing in heaven over God's righteous judgment upon Babylon. That's also the marriage supper of the Lamb. Jesus leads on a white horse into battle to defeat the enemy, casting the beast and the false prophet into the lake of fire. That's at the Battle of Armageddon. And then in Revelation 20, Satan is bound in hell for 1,000 years. The saints rule and reign with Jesus for 1,000. This is the millennial reign of Christ in Revelation chapter 20. Satan's released. He gathers Gog and Magog for one last battle. The Bible says they surround the saints and Jerusalem, and they're destroyed by fire from the mouth of God. Because when the devil is released from hell after 1,000 years of being in hell, he goes on the earth for one last shot at this. And he's going to go and get anyone who's going to listen to him after the whole millennial reign of Jesus Christ and just gather together all the rest of the people that are not believers. And go to battle, and God's just going to open up his mouth and just consume them with fire. Not even a battle. It's not even a battle. It's just, poof, they're done. And see, what's interesting about this, I back up just a little bit. It never says, even though there's all these horrible plagues and massive amounts of people being killed, the Bible never says that everybody on the earth is destroyed. There's still people that make it through, even make it through God's wrath being poured out. Believe it or not. Because there's still people that make it to that millennial reign of Jesus Christ. And you know, that makes sense too. The Bible says that we're going to rule and reign with Jesus Christ. When Jesus Christ sets up his kingdom, he's going to be the king and the final and supreme authority. But depending on your works and what you did for Christ, you're going to be rewarded for the things that you did. And he's going to set you over various cities and in different positions of powers during that 1,000 years. That's going to be some of what's given to you as a reward, is that you get to rule and reign with him over whatever areas he decides to put you at, you know, and over various people. And there's going to be people living all over the world, and not everyone still is going to be a believer, but things are going to operate the way that Jesus Christ intended for them to be on this earth. So we're going to have 1,000 years of the way that God intended things to be done here on earth. His law will be the law of the land, and the people in charge, the people ruling, reigning, are going to be the believers, are going to be, you know, doing whatever it is that God says for them to do. And so that's what happens. And, you know, Gog and Magog, as I mentioned earlier, it's in Revelation chapter 20. for the one last battle. You know, Satan tries to just gather up whoever he can. He's then finally cast into the lake of fire where the beast and the false prophet are. And then comes the great white throne judgment that we use all the time out soul winning, showing people that there's this great judgment. The books are opened, and death and hell and all believers are cast into the lake of fire. Hell is relocated from the center of the earth into outer darkness, into the lake of fire. Revelation 21 then talks about the new heaven and the new earth and the new Jerusalem, the Lamb's wife, and it's described, you know, with all the pearly gates and the streets of gold, and Jesus is the light. There's no darkness and there's no sun because Jesus is the light thereof. That's what's being described in Revelation 21. And then in Revelation 22, you've got the river of life, the tree of life. There's no more curse. The fulfillment of absolutely everything. And then the last words are the warning on changing God's words. That's the brief overview. I know it's brief. It's been 55 minutes already, but it would take a lot longer to read through the entire book of Revelation. So I encourage you to do this study for yourself. And it's one thing to listen to someone else talk about it, preach about it. You're gonna learn some things. You might think about some things you didn't think about before, but you won't really know it until you do it for yourself. Do the study for yourself. Do this and do what I did. I wrote down all the various things that were happening and trying to understand where these fit in. And it actually, and when you read the verbiage too in the book of Revelation, you'll see over and over again, and then this happened, and then this happened, and then this. The words that are being used are very chronological. This happens, and then this happens, and then this happens. So be careful not to be mixing and matching these things and saying, oh, you know, what's happening over in Russia is like what's happening in Revelation chapter 6. And then, wait a minute. There's no way, because these other events haven't even happened yet, and it's giving us this stuff in order. It's giving us these seals in order. They're being opened one after the other. So hopefully this has been a little bit valuable for you. I wanted to provide this overview for you because, like I said, the coming weeks, I'm going to be digging in deep to very specific subjects. We're going to be hitting on Babylon. We're going to be talking about the abomination of desolation. We're going to be looking at various other places in the Bible. We're going to talk about the Antichrist. We'll talk about the one world government. All these various things that are talked about, we're going to go into more detail and see the, you know, from all scripture, the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord's another big event. You know, I talk about doing a timeline based on the sun and the moon being dark and the stars falling from heaven. Another great way to kind of help you to understand the timeline of events, look up the day of the Lord and the day of Christ. Also very good event, you know, big major events that are referred to at many places throughout the Bible, but it's very clear they're referring to the same thing. Because you have the same things happening in the context of where they're being mentioned in the Bible. So hopefully this helped you. I'm excited about this series. If you have any questions, let me know after church. I'm more than happy to talk to you about this. Or as you study it, bring them up. I love this stuff. I'm not unavailable by any means. Let me know what you think, and we'll go from there. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for giving us a book of Revelation, a book that reveals things that are to happen in the end times. God, I pray that you would please help us to be strengthened, help us to do the work that we need to do for you now, because the hard times are coming, persecutions are coming, Lord, and the devil's gonna be kicked out of heaven one day, and we need to be prepared. We need to be able to stand strong. We need to be ready to stand and to not be discouraged or disappointed or just taken completely off guard if we're expecting you to rapture us out and that doesn't happen, Lord. Help us to be prepared mentally, physically, and spiritually, especially, most importantly, dear Lord. Help us to be spiritually prepared for this spiritual battle that we're engaged in, dear God. So in Jesus' name we pray, amen.